So we're ready for the next presenter. And actually, the only native Virgin Island presenter during this series. So I think this is really our guest of honor. Nadine Marchena Kean, who is, according to this, a sixth generation Virgin Islander, who's from St. Thomas and who is a historian working on St. Thomas history and your own family history, and who has been involved in many different sort of historical and local community projects during the years in St. Thomas. So thank you.
Pleasant, good morning.
Good morning.
I thought I would start off in a different way this morning. I know we're still on a early Sunday morning type of movement. I'm accustomed to a touch screen, so. This is the first verse of, and I'm not going to sing, but maybe I should sing. They'll get the music up real quick after that point. It is the first verse and of a song that, as a Virgin Islander, we all know. And it is called Our Culture, and it's by Image Band. And it speaks to who we are as a people. And it talks about looking and preserving our culture. Basically, it says that we are losing our culture, that there are things within our culture that we all know, like red pea soup and fungi, fish and fungi. Some people say fungi and fish on other islands, but we always say fish and fungi. The quadrille. I talked about food. I talked about there are people that we all know, brownie being one of them. I mean, the song goes through and really highlights the culture of the entire Virgin Islands. And so I thought I would play that for you. Maybe we'll play it at the end. But I just wanted to start with that this morning, and I'm not going to sing. My chat today is called If Walls Could Talk. And as you can imagine, as I started off with something about culture, it's about a culture that is created in a small, little neighborhood called Savanne. I became interested in Savanne as I sat at the Caribbean Genealogy Library one day. And my family will tell you that when I go to the library, it's an all-day venture because it's a love. So being in this place today is really something that's special to me. My grandmother was a librarian, and in every book of all of her descendants, her five children, her 24 grandchildren, of which I am the eldest, all have within our homes libraries. They may be a small bookshelf, but they could be large rooms that have books that we love to touch and read and understand and go back to time and time again. So I was sitting at the Caribbean Genealogy Library, and there was someone next to me doing research as well. And as I was sitting there, I was going through the 1846 census, and it is a census of the unfree. And I was helping someone, and I went through the reel, and I got to a page. And there I saw my fourth great-grandmother. Now, I had known that she was African, but I had no idea that I would find her enslaved, sitting there, right there with her children, one of which was my three times great-grandfather, and his sister, who I knew nothing about. Imagine my excitement. In a regular library, things are quiet. But if you ever visit a genealogy library, you will understand that noise is a okay thing. I screamed. It was wow. It was that moment when all my research shifted. I saw that she lived in Savanne. And I knew exactly where the location was. I did not have any pictures of her, and obviously during that time period, there would be no pictures. And so I found this image that is always the image that I think of when I think of Clara, my four times great-grandmother. It is a bust done by Charles Cordier in 1851, and it's called African Venus. And as I study her life, I see that I sort of imagine that she carried herself, even as an enslaved African person living in Savanne, in St. Thomas, with a certain carriage, that she, even though she found herself in this situation, would have a certain level of understanding of herself and a certain pride in knowing that she will do the best that she could do. So this is a representation of my fourth times great-grandmother Clara. That day, I wanted to go straight to Pilestrada, but it was late in the evening and I had to get home. And so I thought to myself, oh my goodness, I need to be able to go to the place and touch the walls to sort of see where she lived and how she lived. I wanted to reach out and touch them and thought to myself, if only walls could talk. I went to sleep that night thinking, oh my goodness, I need to be there. Hence the name of my topic today, If Walls Could Talk. Now, Savanne is a very special place on the island of St. Thomas. It's in the northwestern area of Charlotte Amalie. I can't imagine that many of you have actually been there, maybe five, six? Oh, we have a few. How many of you have come with me through Savanne? Okay. So Savanne has a distinction of being a neighborhood where excellence rises. And when you look at it, you'll find that every governor, except one governor, was born or has some affiliation, that was born in St. Thomas, has some affiliation with Savanne. De Malville, Turnbull, I'm doing them out of order, Snyder, De Young, all have an affiliation with this small area of the territory. But there are other people that have come out of that area as well. And they include musicians Alton Adams and Herbert Brown, communications icon Athneel Addy Otley and Irvin Brownie Brown, boxer Emil Griffith, mathematician Orville Ken, politician Valdemar Hill, John Maduro, and Rothschild Francis, scientists Dr. Gwen Molinar and Roy Watlington, teachers J. Antonio Jarvis, Mildred Watlington Andews, and Lucinda Millen, artists Carlito Ken and Cleve Grapo Turnbull, Bishop Elliot Thomas of the Catholic Diocese, and judges Ive Swan and Wilma Lewis, all have ties to that very small neighborhood. But that only speaks to a few. We can talk about whole families. And when we talk about families, we talk about the Sprouts, the Estrells, the KBs, the Steels, the Schulterbrands, and they go on and on. Let's put it in context. Savanne, and this is a little history of Savanne, you will see it being settled early on. In 1678, it was surveyed, and Savanne was split into three. Jensen, Swine, and Poulsen showing up in the 1688 census, the first census that we have available to us, and they are there already dealing with the property. In 1764, Savanne was parceled out to the free colored population. Now, I have to say that even though this was parceled out, they were living amongst a very international community in Savanne already. And we'll talk a little bit more about that. In 1848, emancipation, Savanne property gets divided even further than it was. And so we have a picture of Savanne today. Oh, before we do that, more history. 1678, Savanne, it's duplicated, okay. So Savanne then looks like this now. It's really just a house plot. There's no big yards, backyards that are attributed to individuals. It is cut up significantly, right? And it goes from hillside to hillside. So more about Savanne. Savanne, and this is a map of Savanne and in the Hindenburg map. So Savanne is surrounded by very big buildings. You have on the edge of Savanne, right around here, not this building, but right around here, is the Masonic Lodge. As you go up, you have the Queen Louise Home for Children that then becomes the Queen Louise Home for the Aged in the Virgin Islands. This is the old Queen Louise Home building. Over here, for the Crusians in the room, there is a building that is called the Durant Tower. Now, we always think of the Durant Tower as a St. Croix-only type situation. But Mr. Durant married a St. Thomian. And as he married a St. Thomian, she decided she was coming back to St. Thomas. So he lived in St. Croix, and he built an identical house, gentlemen in the room, an identical house in the place of her residence choice, which was Savanne. And so there was a Durant Tower right there. Always present, the Catholic Church, down in this area. And then you have the shipping lines, the Hamburg American line, the Bronson line, a Transatlantic line, shipping lines right here south of General Garda, all situated here. We have the bank right here. And right here is a building that no longer exists, right north of the Market Square. And that, very important to our understanding of Savanne, is the Free Negro Corps. It no longer exists. And so I went back and found the footprint of the building and the information about the structure, and it was redrawn and reconfigured for me. So that is what the building looked like right next to the Blyden, now the Stradiron building, right? Just north where that opening in the northern part of the Market Square is. Was a series of buildings, and they were knocked down. So now you get an understanding of Savanne as it stands today. In the study, I wanted to make sure to really look at the understanding of a people, the buildings, and the activities that happened within Savanne. What is a building? Wood, rubble, brick, mortise and tenon? But is that it? Is that all a building is? When we look at a building, we should really think of a frame that holds a picture that is the lives of the people that live within it. I really want you to think about that. As you look at any picture, you look at a building, you should really think about the people that live within that building. As you know, when you move out of a building and the building sits there empty, it dies. And really, it's the people that keep those buildings alive. So the first, I looked at 7 families, 4 buildings within Savanne. And the first one was on Pyle Strada. It is the Passé and Gabriel family, families that are living there. And the Passé family, there are 18 members of their family living at this property. 18 members. They're living in a series of long rows. In fact, they're living in 2 long rows. They're living in 2 long rows, and it's a structure of 3 long rows set up, right? So these long rows are set up in a U-type organization, and the long row looks like that. but 18 members of them are living within the two long rows. So it's really tight. When you talk about a tiny house, this is tiny house living. And if you think about that, it's really amazing. It is a situation where it's 45 feet wide, 14 feet deep. And if it was purely residential, this building would have five families living in it. Early 1800s to late 1800s. You're seeing it all the way through. In fact, there are long rows that are occupied right now in St. Thomas, but they put businesses and some small residential for families that are, for individuals that are coming in recently to St. Thomas. Okay, so your living space would be 9 by 14, right? In the 1841 census, the Gabriel family is living there. And if, as you can imagine, this is my ancestor living at this property. And when you read Dr. Amory Caron's paper, or book, called The Danish Port of Charlotte Amalie, 1790 to 1803, he indicates that few town slaves were provided with housing area of their own. Such a room or a cabin would be what they had. Most port slaves had to bed in a corner of a warehouse, a stock room, under stairs, in a utility room, or crawl space under the building. So this long row did not have a space underneath it. The long row sat on the ground. And the third building where they stayed was actually a workspace. They made furniture. And so they would have to sleep in the corner of the factory space on Pile? Gada? That's how you pronounce it? We say pile. Pile. Okay. So they made furniture and they would sleep in the corner and do lodging in this building. Obviously made of wood, and it had shutters when they did the survey. So I don't know if it had shutters then, when they lived there or not, but definitely when they did the survey, there were shutters. And so I moved to another family, another building. This is on the edge of Savanne, on Storstrada. Familiar names in Denmark. So Storstrada is at the edge of Savanne. It is right before you get to Vestergade. I'm trying. And it is a vernacular building, and the building is right here in the corner. Right there, that's the building. And it had living in it and owning this building, the Ba and the Maloon families. Sproul also lived there. These were free people of color. They were leaders in the militia. And they're the ones, as I study this group of free colored people, they were part of the Free Negro Corps or the Brand Corps. One or the other, they belong to both, depending on who it was we were talking about. And they really, as we look at articles in the newspaper, really started to sort of push towards freedom, the ideas of what they could do. Because even as free people of color, they weren't really free. They were required to wear certain clothes and not to congregate unless given special permission, and they couldn't go certain places or do certain things. They were required to be part of the militia. So they weren't really free, but they pushed towards freedom, and they did things that really were helpful in the success of their families as they went forward. The Ba family, I have to note, came from Senegal, And I don't find any evidence of them ever being enslaved, which is very interesting. They are living in the houses, the free colored houses of the Brandenburgers. And I should have pointed that out. Across from the Catholic Church is the Burns Ice Plant, which was the Brandenburger headquarters. And there is where a lot of the slaves were sold. So the Bar and Maloon and the Sproul families, and the Sproul family that lives here is John B. Sproul and his two children before he goes to St. John. He is the progenitor of all of the Sprouls of St. John, all of them. Huge family, well known on the island of St. John. And when I said to them, well, you know, he's a St. Thomian. It was a surprise to them. He lived right in that building. And I believe, as I study more, I think he is related to the Maloon and the Sprouls very closely. So we've seen a long row. We've seen a vernacular building. And this is what the vernacular building looks like today. It is a building that still exists, and the owner has shuttered it because she doesn't want to put a bar there, but has no funds to really fix it up so that it could be something else. I propose a museum, a living museum, but a museum that talks about the families of that community. It wouldn't take a lot, but it's more than she has at this point to really take care of that particular building. And so right now it's shuttered and is holding for something potential in the future. So there are lots of different buildings, and this building is a rubble construction, mass mason type buildings. The walls are so thick. It is on Burjagada, on the corner of Burjagada and Regeringsgada. Help me out, my Danish friends. Burjagada, say that again, Burjagada. Yeah, what he said. Okay. And the Ba family, another extension of the Ba family, lives here, and the De La Garde family also live here. Very tied to each other. They didn't know how they were related. They knew they were related. They're living in the same household. Their mothers were sisters. And they didn't realize that this is, okay, they're four generations later. Their mother, four generations back, their great-great-great-grandmother and the Ba's great-great-grandmother were sisters. Right? And this building sits as a permanent major structure in Savanne. Yes, small buildings, but there were bigger buildings as well. And she's coming out of Grenada, right? He is a consulate, I believe, to Haiti, and he's also on the colonial council, Mr. De La Garde. So I'm skipping through because I want to get to the end of my document. The Fabio family, this is on Jodegada. That was good? Jodegada. Jew Street. this is on the corner of Small and Jodegada. And it is of mixed construction, right? It's wood upstairs. Downstairs is masonry, brick, and you will see the brick because it's now exposed and I think brick from Flensburg clearly. And it is built, it is the Fabio family. Mr. Fabio marries someone named Claudina. And unfortunately, she is Lutheran, she is a Dane living in the center, and this is really truly the center of Savanne. And there are maybe, I've counted, looking at two or three censuses, I've counted maybe 10 Danes living. But there are people from all around the world living in Savanne, this free colored neighborhood. And she's living with her husband, unfortunately, in the Lutheran record, right as I got to Claudina's last name, it has deteriorated to nothing. So I have no idea who Claudina is. But she indicates that she's Lutheran and she's Danish, and we see the marriage happening in the Lutheran church. And he's a business person. He He starts and loses several businesses, but they're living in this very beautiful home that is now in ruins. Okay, so I want to go back. Can I do that? I can't. Okay, it's fine. So it seems like I've told you about four buildings that have nothing in common, nothing at all. At a first glance, it looks like they're coming, the people are coming from all different countries. They're coming from St. Eustatia, from Curacao, from Denmark, from Grenada, from Africa. The buildings are of different materials, whether they're mixed use, mixed construction, or they're made of wood or rubble. They're built in different ways, from a vernacular to a long row to a major building within Savanne. But closer observation shows that there are several things, major things that they have in common. And I want to point those things out to you. The things that really built the understanding of Savanne today. They have a shared space. They have a community. They have a tradition, a shared tradition, and achievements and benefits and beliefs, The first one is the yard. Now a yard, and I don't know how many of you understand that concept, but the yard is a concept where buildings are built around a central yard type understanding. And in this yard, life happens. You have a kitchen, you have, well, outdoor something, you have bathroom, but more importantly, you have an area where the children of that particular yard is taken care of. There are no latchkey children in this neighborhood because there's always someone that's looking out for the children. And there is a communal understanding of the raising and the understanding of that community. There's also an understanding that we are all together in this. The belief system then merges into something. So each one of them, as you look, here is Pile Strada, where the three long rows, there's two on one side and one on the other side where the business is, and there, it creates a yard. This one is Store Strada, the building that we talked about is in the corner, right? And that creates a yard. Also has a yard. Big, and these two buildings owned by the two sisters at one point. And the one sister dies, the other sister takes over, her husband sells it right away, because you know women can't own property during this time period, right? And then Small Strada, another yard type setup, where the buildings are around a central area and they share their understandings. Their everything, their life comes from that yard. As I did this paper, I did an interview of the people of Savanne. They get together every Saturday to have a meal and share a meal, those that are native Savaneros, which means they might not necessarily live in Savanne anymore, but they go up that hill every day, every Saturday, and they sit down and they have lunch. And they talk about everything from politics to what happened that week. It is a place where politicians will go when they're getting ready to run for governor. Because you want to know, you know, what the Savaneros will do. If the Savaneros say yay, they will win. Unless a Crujan says yay. So Savanne was a destination. It was a place to go for people. They said that people came, when they came home, they would go to Savanne to see family or to visit somebody that they needed to come and see. Or if they just arrived new to the island, Savanne was the place to go because there was always someone there that would greet you and help you, you know, make a home. Educational excellence was critical for them. Education meant everything for them, and they told stories of not only having to go to school, but then afterwards having to go to a trade type setup or situation. Educational excellence, another one of those critical components for them. a protected competitiveness. And what I mean by that is that amongst the Savaneros, they were very fiercely competitive. But as they stepped out of their neighborhood, they were very protective of their Savanero person. They would chair the highest for them. But as they were internal, it was, you know, he is studying, you know, so and so is studying music. What are you doing? Well, I'm studying art. That is a competition. And then finally, there was the diversity and tolerance. So I mentioned earlier that in Savanne, it was laid out for free colored people of that community. However, in that community, you had people from Baltimore, Havana, Flensburg, Gibraltar, Pino and Century in Corsica, the Congo, Isle of Maleri, Copenhagen, Caracas, Scotland, Prussia, the Caribbean, and the Canary Islands. And that was just in the 1841 and 1846 census. People from all around the world. And the types of professions they were involved in included physicians, watchmakers, servants, school mistresses, ship carpenters, clerks, merchants, cigar makers, shopkeepers, painters, editors, clergy, and coppersmiths. Because of this diversity of the neighborhood, it nurtured tolerance of other religions and other languages and cultures. To conclude, one of the aspects of our history that is often ignored, its significance in history lessened, so easily altered or completely destroyed, is that of our built infrastructure. Whether they are imposing buildings or vernacular cottages that surround us, we often forget that these buildings were the places that housed those that arrived from Denmark, from Africa, and from far off places. Savanne was not perfect by any means. We did not talk today about the night soil or the open sewage. But despite that, the people were God-fearing and respectful people. Graciousness was innate to the people of Savanne. The way buildings were arranged and the activities and characteristics of the people created a culture where education and excellence reigned. And because of this, I'm issuing a call to action as I did in the Virgin Islands. We must preserve this culture and the individual stories of every one of our historic towns. In order to do this, we as a community and as an extended family and community who care about the future of these communities need to do something to preserve our built infrastructure and record the shared histories of those that lived within these buildings, not for these people, but for our children. Thank you.
Thank you so much for yet another wonderful presentation about how a place is not just a physical space, but something that goes much further beyond that. So are there any questions or comments? Yes. Start from behind.
Yeah. First and foremost, I really want to thank you. You are one of the very few Virgin Islanders who are discussing the history and culture of the Virgin Islands. I am from the university, and this is the first time I'm hearing such a wonderful lecture. So I just want to thank you, and I hope there would be a way to come and educate the young Virgin Islanders in the schools as well at the university. I have two questions about the families, the Sprau and the Ba. I was surprised when I heard the Ba family came from Senegal. It was maybe it's a wrong understanding. I thought the Bach family, in many ways, do not look like just came from Senegal. And I don't know when the change took place, if you would elaborate on that one. And the second question is, you talk about the Sproul moving to St. John. Are you talking about the dentist Sproul who moved, or that was
his grandfather
before that?
Okay, so let's start with the Ba family. In the matricles, and I haven't done a lot of research on the Ba's, but in the matricles you will see B-A-A-E and so forth. You're seeing them free early on, and the idea is that they came over with the Brandenburgers on one of the ships from the Brandenburgers, but they had a special deal, I guess. I don't know. I really don't know the details of the family. But of course, they married immediately, and they didn't marry other people from Senegal because there was no one else, I think, that was there at the time. They're marrying these young ladies coming from Grenada, and there is a series of women that come in. I think there are six of them that are coming in from, oh my goodness, there's an island off of Africa, I'm losing names now, on the eastern side of Africa, on the southern eastern side of Africa. Madagascar. We have six women coming in from Madagascar, and I think one of them, one of the Ba's, marry one of those young ladies. But we're seeing several marriages immediately, and so that is where you're going to get the look of the Ba, I guess. The Sprouls, John B. Sproul would have been Dentist Sproul, I believe, grandfather, and so it's before that. Altiman Sproul and so forth, there are a series of generation above Dentist Sproul, and then this would be their father.
Thank you so much, Nadine. It was a pleasure. I was just thinking, now you ended your presentation with a call to action. And I was just wondering if you would like maybe a little bit to elaborate on some of the already call into action projects, like the Community Now projects and the board up and cleanup that you've been doing yourself. Yeah.
Okay, so I'm here as a person that is fiercely interested in the Virgin Islands, history and culture. However, my job is as director of the Virgin Islands Economic Development Authority's Enterprise Zone Commission, and our job is to revitalize once vital, vibrant communities that are now considered distressed. And so the neighborhoods that we deal with are Christiansted, the historic town of Christiansted and Frederiksted on St. Croix, and Garden Street and Up Street, which is the hospital ground area, and Savanne and Down Street, which will go down street, goes all the way down to the cemetery. So in each of the quarters, right? King's Quarter, Kongens Quarter, Drenagens Quarter, and Comprinsens Quarter, we have zones. And we attempt to do various different things. Now, my budget is very small, and we have the whole territory to deal with. So my budget is $50,000 to $60,000 a year. That's not a lot of money. And we attempt to revitalize buildings, to get people to deal with their multiple ownership, because some of these buildings come down from slavery, owned as they come right out of slavery, they purchase their buildings, and then they have handed it down generation after generation after generation. Imagine one of those small buildings being owned by 34 individuals. They're all family. What do you do? How do you deal with that? So we have stepped forward to do initiatives like estate planning, so that people won't find themselves in this situation. Or we do histories of the families and do the genealogy so that we can try to get them to talk to each other. Some people have left the territory, their grandfather left the territory, and they have never seen this building, ever. They have no idea. So we have buildings that have an enormous amount of history. You could imagine when I walk through Savanne, I don't see it the way that you see it. I see histories of families that really talk about the history of the territory. I can tell you that a Greek family lived in that building. And they came from, they were Greeks through Corsica, through Florida, to St. Thomas. Orthodox, practicing in the Catholic Church. I can tell you that Italians came, or Africans built this building. I can tell you those details, and it's in my head. And we are working on doing things like scraping and painting some buildings. Sometimes that's all it takes for it to be occupied, right? Or we are also doing some revitalization. Some of the bigger projects, which we're thankful to Denmark for, and the group of building historic building owners, BUFO, they have made available $10 million per district for us to revitalize a key anchor building. As a community has done charrette projects and said, we would like to move forward in this direction, and here are buildings, here is a building that is our anchor building that will spur revitalization. And so that donation has come forward in order for us to do that. And so there are two buildings, one on the island of St. Croix, on Hospital Street is what it's called, because they use English, and one on St. Thomas on Hospitalgade. I'm really wrecking your language today. But so those projects, in search of identity projects, are moving forward, and so we're thankful for that. But there are so many, many projects of small little vernacular buildings that just need a little extra touch. If you want to volunteer and come to the Virgin Islands to take hold of a building, we have a building for you. If you just want to send money, I am a good steward of money.
Any one last question? It's too much. We don't have time
okay,
for
I'll
that.
Okay, I'll do short answers.
Yeah, short. I think...
So we could do two.
Well, just do one last question here, and then the rest.
Actually, I'll pass, Nadine. I'll catch up with you later. But I want to put this out there for everybody, just real quick, is I think one of the other issues, too, having lived in St. Croix for several years, is that there's an issue with getting our youth involved in these projects and demonstrating the value of these spaces to the youth, so that they become stewards of the past. And so I'm interested, and we could talk maybe later about what programs you have available to teach the youth trades in order to help facilitate not only the preservation of these important spaces, but also provide our young people from there with skills that help them to get work and continue to develop professionally.
Awesome. I'm glad you mentioned that. As I return later on this month, we have Entrepreneur starting, which is a youth program. I would like to say, though, thank you to the Danish West Indian Society, the Friends of Denmark, and the National Historic Danish National Archives, the Solar Foundation, and my host, Louise Sabro, thank you so much.